Strategies, how you should adopt your strategies to the changing market conditions.
Talking about some major developments that are taking place in Indian market. Starting with emergence and growth of modern retail formats, huge proliferation of brands, variants, SKUs, channels, choices. You know about SKUs? Stock keeping units. Various packaging sizes. Because you have to give a lot of variety to your prospective customers. The digital revolution, growing contribution of Middle India, I'll talk about it a little later, the concept of Middle India. Peri-urban and rural marketing, fortune not at the bottom of the pyramid. We have a general perception that there is a fortune at the bottom of the pyramid. But the point is, there is certainly a fortune at the bottom of the pyramid, but it's for the long haul. I mean, there are a lot of challenges in rural market, you know, because of poor infrastructure, the family income being low, and then the regulatory income, there is a problem. The cost of distribution is too much. So for many marketers, it becomes highly uneconomic to penetrate deeper into the rural market. So there are a lot of challenges. So, but then there is certainly a fortune just sitting above the bottom of the pyramid. I'll come to this. Moving from time to market to time to acceptance. Sustainable business marketing practices and new consumer behavior trends. I'll go by one by one, and within the limited time, class time, I'll try to do some justice to all these points. Let's begin with emergence and growth of modern retail formats. Just to give you an idea, retail universe in India, the overall retail market in India has grown at a compound annual growth rate of 12% in the last 4 years to reach between 350 to 385 billion in financial year 2012 as per some PricewaterhouseCoopers analysis. You know about billion trillion relation, you know?
Yes,
1,000 times billion is trillion. 1,000 times million is billion. 1,000 times billion is trillion. Okay, so.
Sir, what is CAGR? Compound
annual growth rate. To avoid fluctuations from year to year, compound annual growth rate takes care of an uniform growth rate, the average growth rate over a particular period. As per BCG report, this is another major international consultancy firm, Boston Consulting Group. They had a report called The Tiger Roars, which was published in February 2012. As per BCG, overall consumer spending in India, from 991 billion in 2010, it's likely to reach 3.6 trillion by 2020, which means in another 6 years' time, this total consumer spending is likely to go up by 3.6 times, nearly 4 times. This projected 14% annual growth rate is much higher than the anticipated annual global growth of 5.5% and even faster than the estimated 9% growth in emerging economies. There was a similar study done by AC Nielsen, is another market research firm. They are more known for their retail audits. The spending on FMCGs in particular at modern retail stores is likely to go up from 1.8 billion to 5 billion by 2010, almost by 3 times. Indian share of global consumption will constitute around 6%, 5.8% by 2020, as compared to the present share of about 2.7%. It's going to almost double. Explosive growth of e-tailing is another major development. E-tailing is online retailing.
Electronic
retailing. While e-tailing accounts for less than 0.5%, less than 0.5% of overall retail market in India, the size of this market has reached between 5,000 to 6,000 crores during 2012. So in spite of being less than 1% of the total retail market, the size itself is quite substantial. It is somewhere between 5,000 to 6,000 crores as of now. Now, e-tailing in India is today mainly focuses on non-grocery products such as consumer electronics, media products, consumer appliances, books and garments. Many of you might be buying, ordering online from time to time. Even people do buy, people like you would be possibly placing orders for t-shirts and things like that. The use of social media sites like Facebook and Twitter has shot up in recent years. However, only a tiny minority uses these sites for shopping, although India has 6 million Facebook users, the third largest in the world. So, over a period, the use of social sites, particularly to promote various products, even by big companies, is a major phenomenon now. Modern retail has also brought in changes in pricing models. Now, pricing model has become very dynamic, almost on real-time basis. So in a modern retail store, you know, like Spencer or Big Bazaar, at any point of time, they can play around with the prices. They can really track the sales, the rate at which the products are moving out of the shelf. At any point of time, they can see the situation and accordingly make changes in the prices, almost on real-time basis. Like you have, you know, the kind of pricing model you have in while buying air tickets. So almost on real-time basis. Moreover, some products may be cheap to buy. Another phenomenon is the people don't really look at the MRP alone. They see the total price. What is total price? That is cost of ownership. You know, you buy a product which may be cheap, but maybe costly to maintain. So you better have a look at the total price and see the cost of ownership and then take a decision. So people are getting smarter these days. Advent of private label products is another recent phenomenon. You would have possibly noticed while you go to big shops like Big Bazaar or Spencer, many of the products, particularly grocery products, they would be selling at their by their own label, you know. Or and particularly in some cases, lot of garments, you know, you go for buying some shirt these days, particularly for retailing, they are selling lot of private level self-branded products through retailing. So that is another phenomenon which is as much as 7% of the modern trade. Even you go to Big Bazaar, particularly for general merchandise, you know, things like floor cleaners, you will find there are certain reputed brands, national level brands, and there are also Big Bazaar would have introduced their own brands. Through contract manufacturing. Now, private labels have been introduced by almost all the big organized retailers like Spencer's, Big Bazaar, Reliance, Westside and things, and such other shops, particularly in FMCG, groceries and apparel categories. The value-seeking Indian consumers and his comfort with unbranded or generic products is key to the growth of such private labels in India. In years to come, their share is likely to go up. Modern retail has also brought in changes in pricing models, which I was just explaining. Modern trade is also driving new trends in consumer behavior. See, lot of premium products are moving fast due to the advent of modern retailing. Now, premiumization, which you call premiumization. Premiumization, modern trade is a significant driver of premiumization. The premium segment, in particularly in FMCG sector, is growing at 46%, which is much higher than the overall FMCG growth of 19%. This is another recent trend. And there are key impulse categories like biscuits, chocolates, confectionery, salty snacks. They are clocking high double-digit growth, rapid increments in retail presence in spite of high inflation. And there are a lot of innovations are taking place. Since people are becoming more and more health conscious, you will have these days
lot of snacky foods which are baked, not fried. So people tend to opt for such products. Modern trade, better availability, small packs, and product innovations are driving the growth of these categories. What are the other key growth drivers? Convenience. By the way, yesterday I sent you a mail. This is the first time in India some entrepreneur has thought of starting a fully automated restaurant. This is the first time in India someone in Chennai has started this operation, which is almost without there being any human interference. I mean, you have everything is automated. Walk into the shop, place your order, make the payment by debit card or ATM card, and get your food, choice of your food, duly heated and packed for ready delivery. So, which is what? People need more convenience, and so they're saving on their time, and they don't have to really wait to for their orders to be served. They can, you know, it takes barely a few minutes for them to walk in and get their food delivered. So convenience is one major driving factor. Consumers are increasingly looking for solutions to help them manage their energy level in order to cope with the demands of everyday life. Particularly among working couple who are willing to pay premium for such products. So these days you have got a lot of convenience foods which are, you know, you have got ready-made, ready to cook, idlis, ready to cook vada, and all sorts of are now get to see. Health and wellness. People are becoming more health conscious. In fact, the sale of fast food chains are going down day by day. So people are possibly frequenting to such chains like McDonald's less often. Eatables which serve as nutritious dietary supplements such as cereal bars, baked snack products, etc. are growing as healthier alternatives to fast food, particularly among the urban population, young urban population. Another thing is that people are more, these days, more conscious to the environmental issues. So people would like to know whether the particular company, that's why people are willing to pay premium for organic foods, right? And also whether particularly the food products which are procured while processing, whether such foods are being grown, they're practicing sustainable agricultural practices. So in one such in case of Kisan Ketchup, as they claim in their POP displays, that is point of purchase displays, that they claim that 60% of tomatoes which they procure for manufacturing Kisan Ketchup are being sourced sustainably. Then there is huge proliferation of brands, variants, SKUs, channels, and choices. A double-edged sword, which means what? I mean, it's a challenge, and both a challenge and an opportunity. Okay. Now, just look at the trend. Before liberalization, we had only three car brands with very few models. Before the 90s, 4 years ago, we had roughly 80 models of cars. Today, we have about 150 models of cars, excluding the variants. Right? So this is the scenario today. We are being spoiled for choice. Now, till the turn of the century, we had only one life insurance service provider, that is LIC. Today, we have got about 23 of them. Whole lot of private players have come into the market. Delhi and Mumbai started off with only two mobile service operators. Today, we have at least 8 mobile service providers in each metro, and mobile handsets are another greater example. So marketing challenges, there's a whole lot of clutter.
Declining loyalty, hardships in distribution.
So much distribution is a major challenge.
And also increase in the cost of promotion. There are being so many variants and you have to promote each and every variant.
So the cost of promotion has gone up. And to rise your voice above the level of clutter is itself is a very big challenge.
A few years ago, a single soap served to wash the entire body. Now in just one segment of the market, there are body washes, face washes, hand sanitizers, and you name it. Right? So brand universe, that means in a particular category, how many brands are fighting with each other in a particular product category? So earlier there used to be barely 5 such major brands in a particular category. Now we have come to a situation where in a particular category you may have as many as 20 brands fighting with each other for the shelf space, for the space in the consumer's mind. The positioning is a major challenge. Now, while there are about 20 brands in a product category, still a marketing guy has to find a place in a consumer's mind among the first three for easy recall. So that's a very big challenge. Therefore, a marketer would need to have stronger product needs and be more sharply differentiated. How do you differentiate between these various brands? Okay, that's a major challenge. Now, so to the key to successful marketing or branding is to provide it. Now, branding, the other day I was telling you, branding, whatever you do for branding, ultimately the product has to perform. So, what people are looking for is total experience, the memorable experience. Now, it comprises everything. Marketing, branding is everything, right from production to distribution to supply chain, logistics, promotion, distribution, everything put together, and after sales service, you have to, people look at the totality of the experience. Right? So the marketing is a very challenging task, more challenging today. Today's generation flux, very little loyalty as people have been flooded with choices. What is generation flux? Generation flux is, you know, we had a terminology called generation Y. Okay. Now we call, we have a faced with the situation where people are less brand loyal. That means the constant changes that are taking place in the marketplace, we have become kind of immune to it. We take it for granted. It's not a big deal. You know, some time ago we had three major mobile handset companies. Okay? Nokia, BlackBerry, and Motorola. Three majors. Okay? Then the total equation changed altogether with the advent of Android operating system. Now you hardly hear about BlackBerry. Nokia is trying to come back,
struggling
and trying to gain market share after losing heavily to others, particularly to iPhone. So ever since iPhone came into being, now we have got two or three major players, primarily Samsung and iPhone. Right? So this is the situation. Now, as per AC Nielsen India, in FMCG category, in 2009, we had 67,000 stock keeping units. Today, it was as per their survey in 2010, they found we have in FMCG category we had more like 1,20,000 stock keeping units. So look at the challenge. So for marketers, the challenge is to craft sophisticated differentiation strategies, and for manufacturers to come out with such wider assortment. A pricing game would kick off. The brands and manufacturers will have to focus big time on innovation to attract and retain customers. The brands which are critical at the consideration stage often lose out during the actual purchase. The last 3 feet at the store is the moment of truth. Key purchase decisions are taken at the store. What is moment of truth? Moment of truth is the point of interaction between the customer and the company. In whatever way, through advertising, through publicity, through personal interaction, over telecall, whatever. So, and which means at that particular point when the customer is interacting with the company's product or company's person, he is at that point in time, he is taking a major decision whether to purchase or not to purchase. Okay, so you have to really handle each moments of truth very carefully. Okay, so your salesman, your whatever you do to interact with your customer, every interaction has to be managed very well, very strategically. Right, so many times while we go for shopping, we may have in our mind few list of particular brands which are preferred, and when you ultimately walk into the store, many times we get swayed away by the kind of displays they have, kind of point of purchase promotions they have, and we may alter our decisions and we can fall for their promotional scheme and end up buying something else. Depending on the kind of incentive that I may be offered for purchasing a particular product. So if the incentive is very attractive, I may drop my earlier plan and end up buying something else. Critical role of logistics function in marketing for customer satisfaction. In fact, logistics is playing a very major role because there have been so many SKUs, so many, you have to give a wider choice and make sure that you present your particular product in a particular form, particular packaging, particular size, in particular quantity, at a particular price, at a time which is convenient to them. So it's a very big challenge. Just to give you an example, let us consider Apple. Parts for the iPad and iPhone are sourced from many countries and manufacturing is primarily done in China. Right. Apple has 365 stores in 15 countries in addition to its online Apple store. And during the initial phase, an iPad was being bought every 3 seconds. So that was the rate at which an Apple iPad was being bought from all over the country. Now, just imagine, imagine the role of logistics chain function.
All over the world.
Logistics chain function, from forecasting and ordering parts, assembling, shipping in response to orders from all over the world, and still meeting customer expectations for timely delivery. Okay. So, logistics is also part of branding. You do everything, you create a big hype, and when I go to the shop and I don't find the product, you know, your whole marketing exercise goes for a toss. So make sure that every activity is done well and synchronized well in a manner which gives ultimate total a very good customer satisfaction in its totality. Then the major development has been in the front of digital revolution. Speed and depth of information access. Now we getting information about a company and its products is very easy. Go to the website, you get a whole lot of information. Prices can be changed at any time on the internet and conveyed immediately to the purchaser. Shift towards closer interaction and interactive marketing development with consumers, potential triers, and with loyal advocates is not a problem anymore. It has also altered the basis of advertising. It's become very cost effective and it can be highly targeted. Advertising has to become storytelling. The advertiser should spend as much time talking to consumers as listening to them. Now, advertising, online advertising, it is rather less intrusive. When you buy, when you are watching a TV serial and suddenly there's an advertising, many times people get irritated because it's rather bothering you, it's disturbing you. Whereas, while you do online advertising, you tend to advertise in a particular site. Supposing you want to advertise a sports good, okay? So rather you will advertise while you are doing online advertising, you will try to see which are the sites the sport loving people tend to visit the sites, and you will advertise your product only in those sites so that it doesn't become intrusive, rather people would welcome. So today's advertising, marketing and advertising is more of an content management rather than the campaign management. You go with the particular content that the people, so it doesn't, no longer becomes intrusive.
Sir, what is the difference between content management and campaign management?
Campaign management is usually you do campaign management. You choose a certain medium and run your campaign through print medium, through electronic medium in TVs and all. So irrespective of the fact that whether people would rather appreciate your advertising in a particular medium, they will appreciate your advertising in a particular medium only when they are fond of that particular medium. You do campaign management, but you ignore a whole lot of things. Whereas in case of online advertising, you only advertise your products in such medium, in those particular websites, where it will gel with the content. It will gel with the content, so that it becomes less obtrusive, intrusive, and people would appreciate, people would give more attention to your products. So taking care of the contents which your target customers tend to like or appreciate, that is the name of the game, which becomes more effective. Now, the digital world not only springs new media and vehicles, but also opens up endless opportunities for addressing individual customer with fully customized messages at affordable rates. So you can customize your messages targeted to a particular target group by way of advertising, by taking care of the contents in which your target customers are interested in. So that way it becomes more effective. Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
This is what I was talking about. From campaign management to content management. Another point is, mobile phones with internet connectivity, large population, particularly in India, are connected to the internet primarily through mobile phones. Okay? Point of inflection means the point at which it has given a major shift. Generally, when a car, it goes from plus to minus, the concavity changes from plus to minus. So going by the same simile, point of inflection is at a point where you would witness a major change by making mobiles affordable to a large mass of customers with more internet connectivity has given rise to a situation where whole lot of population is now can access internet through their mobiles, and
online advertising can reach a large mass of people, which was not possible earlier. Mobile phones and internet connectivity have provided that point of inflection, bringing the net within easy reach of millions of customers. In another 3 years, 60% of all phones in India will be internet enabled. Now 250 million phones are internet enabled and 42% of these consumers access internet, up from about 19% in 2010-11 as per StatCounter. There is another organization called StatCounter. They keep track of all these trends, internet trends. So the digital audience is not captive and will make a choice on moving into spaces that it find interesting. This is what I was talking about while explaining content management. Your digital audience is not a captive audience. They will move to a place where it is find interesting. So you better advertise for your products in those sites where your target customers are would like to visit. So content management is now a very important factor. The marketers will be successful when they integrate with the content that the audience is consuming. Digital revolution now reaching rural India. UChoppal is more or less an old story now. ITC initiated this exercise. They made internet easily accessible to a large mass of rural consumers through by installing internet kiosks, internet enabled computers at various places, and each internet enabled kiosk had a reach of a number of farmers around five to six villages around that particular center, and it was reaching 4 million farmers in 40,000 villages through 6,500 internet enabled kiosks, with each kiosk serving 5 to 6 villages. What happened is, sometime ago, a few years ago, they were primarily using these e-choppers, this internet enabled kiosks, these computers. It was serving whole lot of useful purposes to the customer, to your rural customers. One was that they could place an order for their products, which were being made available to the farmers. They also had a kind of modern retailing called Chopal Sagar in various places. They were also utilizing this e-chopper for procurement. A farmer, if some farmer had to sell his produce, he could intimate through this internet kiosk, and of course it was supported by offline infrastructure through which they could where the farmers could come, get their produce weight, and could get a better price directly from the company. And it was going on very successfully, but at some point in time, government put restrictions on agricultural exports. So they started it was a little setback, but then they started giving the same service to the farmers. Suddenly it transformed from e-chopper to m-chopper. So you could get access the same kind of service through internet enabled mobile phones. So now mobile phones are playing a key role in ITC's efforts to reach 34,000 odd villages within those 10 states where they had this e-choppers. It was a major success story. Future of marketing is not analog or digital, but paid media, owned media, and earned media. Paid media is generally what we all know: advertisements through newspapers, TVs, and websites. It is paid media. What is owned media? That is web stores. Companies have their web stores, as well as contents distributed on the web across social media and websites. Right? This is owned media. What is earned media?
Number of likes.
You know, that you have to earn. How many of your target customers are really liking your products?
Commenting favorably on your products
and services. So marketers, but marketers, they have to manage all this. Other than paid media, they also have to manage own media and earned media. Otherwise, they will fall way behind others. So marketers who do not leverage owned and earned, which are primarily digital, will find themselves disadvantaged against their competitors. New dimensions of product, price and place in digital age. So another new phenomena is price. Please. Many of the mobile phones, if you buy online, you get at a much cheaper rate. Many of the things. Because they have done away with all the intermediaries. In fact, so much so, it has bothered some big companies so much that they have gone to war. You know, sometime back in Economic Times, there was a news story I was reading. Toshiba and Lenovo, they said that, look, we don't authorize online marketers to market our products. They said, you know, to buy, you better buy from our dealers, because their dealers' interests are the dealers are complaining. Because they find it tough to compete with online retailers. In some cases, Canon says that, look, if you buy online, you get less warranty period. But if you buy offline through our dealers, you get 15 months warranty. Whereas if you buy online, you get about a year's warranty. So they're differentiating. But it is not always fair. I mean, ultimately, you have to find ways and means to make more value addition so that your offline distribution chain also survives. So they have to become more innovative as to how to cope or compete with online retailers. This is a big challenge. We talk about Steve Jobs' legendary iTunes model, which is more democratic. You know, when Apple launched their iStore, they said that, look, I give you a good choice, wider choice. You don't have to buy the whole, like earlier you used to buy for one or two favorite songs, you had to buy the whole CD, right? Now they said that you can choose any song, and for each song you pay the same price. You don't have to buy the whole collection. So that kind of choice is now available to the customer. So because of the cyber bazaar concept, marketplace is no longer tangible. Marketplace, so the concept of pricing, the same P's also hold good. So 4 P's of marketing still hold good, but you have to adopt those 4 P's to the changing market situations. We all know about tremendous success of IRCTC, railway booking and Make My Trip travel. It has become life so simple. You don't have to go all the way to the market or go to an agent shop to get my tickets booked. It's so easy. The concept of place factor has also become wider than ever before. Interestingly, this is an interesting example. One of the Indian hospital chains, namely Max Healthcare, successfully launched, we call it Shatabdi strategy, by way of opening their hospitals in cities connected by the Shatabdi Express, which allowed them mobility to our patients and doctors. Max Hospital, there's one in Gurgaon, they're opening one in Dehradun, connected by Shatabdi Express, right? So 4P model certainly remains relevant, but the setting and managing of each P dynamically for the desired value provision has become more difficult, more challenging. Let's go to another aspect of major development, which is urbanization. The rapid pace of urbanization that is taking place. At what rate? In 2001, we had 35 metropolitan cities, that is city with more than 1 million, 10 lakh population. In 2011, we had 50. 2031, estimated to be, we would likely to have 87 of them. Metropolitan cities. This is as per some study made by National Institute of Urban Affairs. They had a report on urban infrastructure and services in 2011.
So Indian urban population will be close to 600 million by 2031. That is almost 41% of total India's population will be in urban area. Okay. This is the likely scenario in 2030. Another study was done, similar study was done by McKinsey. India urbanization econometry model, it was they also predicted by 2030. In 2030, the likely projected figure for population is likely to be around 1470, nearly 1500 million, out of which nearly 600 million will be the urban population, which is equivalent to 40%. Growth in non-metro urban cities trends in consumption patterns. The consumption pattern in non-metro cities, what has been the growth, and many of the, they have also identified, as per some Ernst & Young study, they had a report called the New Market Shares, Tapping Potential Beyond Metros. The structure of urban India is as follows. Driving growth in later stage consumption. What is later stage consumption? The premium products. One is early stage consumption. Low income group, they are primarily concerned with basic necessities in life, and when your income level goes up, you when your basic necessities have been fulfilled, are met, then you go for premium products. Driving growth in later stage consumption are the six metros: Delhi, Bombay, Chennai, Kolkata, and also Hyderabad and Bangalore. They have also identified 22 key urban towns in terms of market potential, like Amritsar, Ludhiana, Surat, etc., which are more or less mimicking the growth that is taking place in the metro cities. Right? In fact, you will find that the growth rate in these key urban towns with respect to several product categories is much more than what you have in metros. And driving growth in early stage consumption is the rest of urban India. So the key urban towns exhibit consumption patterns similar to those in metros. Organized retail chain presence has increased considerably in such towns and rest of urban India. Growth of number of malls in key urban towns in last 2 years has been 55% as compared to 24% in metros. Increasing preference for premium products and services of established brands in also in key urban towns. And significant uptake in leisure and lifestyle spends also in key urban towns. Nowadays you will find a whole lot of people from these other non-metro cities are also going for foreign travel and things like that. Now, look at the size of the Indian market. It's one of the biggest in the world. Consuming class of mass consumption, by some rough estimate, it's likely to be around 550 million in 15 plus age group. What they have done is, this study done by Technopack Analysis, another well-known auditing and market research company. In their report called Changing India, Changing Consumption, Changing Consumers, which was brought out in 2010, they have excluded this population, which are below 15 years. They are not in below 15 years, they are not in this category, about 350 million. Ultra rich, they are also not the people for mass consumption, about 5% of the population. And below poverty line families, about 225 million. So if you exclude them from the total population, you end up with 550 million people in the consuming class for mass consumption. And out of 550 million, 400 million are in rural India, rest in urban India. And out of this 150 million in urban India, they are widely dispersed all over the country. Very, very broad-based. Now, this is another study by National Council of Applied Economic Research. They regularly do a survey on annual household income and expenditure. So, they have identified some major income groups. One is deprived classes less than lakh and 50,000 annual income, household income. as far as between 1,50,000 to 3,40,000, roughly 1.5 to 3, which is the emerging middle, which is the aspiring class. I'll come to this. They are the one who have got a large number with also purchasing capacity, and of course the middle class, 3,40,000 to 17,00,000, with land share of the total income, and reaches more than 70,00,000. Now see how this trend has been over the last years. Distribution income by household category. See, interestingly, the middle class by 2025, they will have the land share almost close to 50%, about 48% of the total population. This is increasing dramatically. Rich class, which has been around barely 10% in 2010, is likely to reach a little over 30% in 2025. And these two classes are falling down. Now it's a good sign, yeah. Yeah. Now the reason being, the aspiring class and depriving class, actually they are moving up with the rising level of income. More and more people from the aspiring class is getting into middle class, more and more people from middle class is getting into the rich class. And this is a good sign that both of them, the share of the population income, in the income group is falling down. And in 2025, barely 2% of the population will be in that deprived class. So this is the kind of trend we can see in the near future, and which is a good sign for the marketers. Rise of the middle class. Let us take note of it. How the middle class is rising and how they are becoming one of the largest markets in the world. As per Deloitte, another consultancy organization, middle class in Brazil, Russia, India, China, that's BRIC countries, and in Indonesia, Mexico, Turkey, and Vietnam is large and growing. Now, the reason being that large number of woman force in coming into the working class. With heightened discretionary spending power, it is now the ability to spend more on healthcare, children education, and financial products from their savings. This growing middle class is also pushing consumer credit primarily for houses and cars. Now, see their contribution. In India, middle class households account for almost 50% of some of the premium products. 49% of all cars being bought by the middle class households, 53% of all air conditioners, 46% of all credit cards. Now the middle class population is expected to rise tenfold over the next 15 years. Okay. In future, the middle class will not only be the major driving force of the Indian economy, but also the aggregate purchasing power of this category will result into creation of one of the largest markets in the world. Now see, I'll take you to the other than the middle class, we have something called emerging middle. Now I'll briefly show you this particular slide. This is now this traditional triangular shape of the income categories, income distribution, is undergoing a drastic change. The triangular shape is becoming more and more like a diamond shape. This VOP, the bottom of the pyramid, we have about 460 million people. So there is certainly a fortune at the bottom of the pyramid, but not in the near future. It's for the long haul. Only the companies with big, deep pockets can really enter into this and sustain over a period. Okay. Many a people who had entered into this but retracted eventually. And we have got about this emerging middle, this is what I'm talking about. Aspiring class, which is more than the number of people in this aspiring class, is more than what you have in BOP class, and not only being more in number, they have got more purchasing power. So actually, the Fortune is lying right now, lying at this level, which is sitting just at the top of BOP. Okay. There are 470 million, and in middle class we have between 3 to there's some other classification roughly 170 million. Okay, so this is middle class. Then put together, middle class and emerging middle is possibly the world's largest consuming class. Just imagine, even this 470 million is much more than the population of USA. USA is little over 300 million. It is 470 million.